Good evening and welcome to the City Council Committee of the Whole meeting for November 16, 2015 for the City of Sammamish. Let's see, first on our agenda is public comment. I don't know if we have a list, but this is an opportunity for the public to address the council.
I think
3 minutes limit per person or 5 minutes of representing the official position of a recognized community organization. Nothing? No one here for public comment? Nope. Okay. Public comment is in fact closed.
My comment was directed to you, Janet. If you wanted to talk, please do so.
It's all right. Sorry.
Come on up there.
It's okay. It's okay.
The city are waiting.
All right. So next on our agenda is our, I think we're going to get a little bit of an update later, but our main agenda item is the mid-biennial budget update. Mr. City Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think we gave you a very comprehensive report at the last meeting, and then we had some questions. We answered them. So we have a couple questions that we wanted to do follow-up, but frankly, we didn't have that many questions coming. Assuming that our presentation was so effective, so comprehensive, that I want to thank again our finance department. They always do that. I know it's not an exciting topic, but
okay.
You know, I'm hoping that we'll do this answers and questions. Mr. Mayor, I, and the members of the council, it's one item. We don't need to be here till 10 o'clock, 9 o'clock. No, we have another council meeting coming tomorrow night, too, so I'm hoping that we'll get out of this meeting at a reason. I'm hoping they go home, too, because of the budget.
Get out of here.
So I'm going to turn it over to our finance director to give his answers to some of the questions.
You did the 30,000 level? Yeah, let's go up to 50 tonight. Yeah.
I not have 98 slides tonight.
Oh, good.
I think I'm down to 10 tops. So
good.
Thank you. We tonight we'll go over, we had a few questions submitted from our last presentation. One of them we answered through email, Councilmember Jaron's question about the ratio of the impact fees, and it seems that that's satisfied the question. So tonight, a couple of more follow-up questions. All courtesy of Councilmember Jaron. The first one regarding the Fire District 10 contribution, it's on page 6. This is the contribution that the city receives from Fire District 10. It's based on a promissory note, a 20-year promissory note that began in 1999, will terminate in 2019. This is where we receive the annual payments of $89,440. I think the key question here is, does the obligation continue if Fire District 10 becomes part of the Regional Fire Authority? And yes, it does. They assume the assets and liabilities, and we did receive legal guidance on that answer.
Thank you.
The second is a question regarding the City Manager's Department communication budget on page 9. Currently, there's $2,000 allocated in 2016. And the question was posed, should we increase this to $10,000 to allow for programs such as roundtables or new technologies? And each of these questions I'm paraphrasing. A response is that the contingency funding is available in 2016 if the council wishes to get started on anything like this. And as well, we can address a long-term need in the 2017 and 18 budget development process, which will be beginning in just a few months away from now. So.
Yeah, Councilmember Keller.
I'm curious about the new technologies when I saw Councilmember Jaron's email regarding this. Maybe think of the website and the, I know the software is something that we were trying to work on this year. I'm assuming that budgeted for. But is there a budget for content to work on the website that would be in a number that already exists?
Right. So that's not included in the website redesign. That was basically get the technology up to 2016 technology. And there are several things on the front. We work mostly through the eCityGov Alliance, and they've talked about things like open government platform, where there's more data available online and can be pulled in and out. Right now, we have a lot of our data available on our website. It's in PDF format primarily. So there's different, that's just one example. There's several other items like that out there on the technology side that could be something that if council wish to explore, we can have more information on that.
It is something I think that we can talk about on the retreat. I was wondering if
Bob, is your mic on? Is your mic on? I got two comments about that.
Thank you. Yeah. My question would be then, it might be something we can talk about at the retreat in terms of allocating dollars for content and that. I just wondered if there was dollars already there. Thank you.
Any Councilmember Jaron?
Thank you, Joe. What you're saying is that perhaps we don't have to change the budget, but if we decide as a council to explore some of these possibilities, like the roundtables, we can take it out of the contingency.
Correct.
So rather than changing the budget now, do that.
Makes more sense.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments on that? Are we settled on that issue, I guess? Mm-hmm. Okay, good.
Next question was I apologize, I don't have the question posed here, but the question was for social and human services. The funding that is available every year and grant funding to the different agencies, what is the grant funding by jurisdiction and the per capita? And so City of Bellevue, 2015 grant funding, notice their grant funding is approximately $3.2 million, followed by City of Kirkland at $760,000, and then Redmond at $750,000. These are actually, I should have sorted them by a per capita basis, but they are in alphabetical order, so it's a little harder to track. You'll notice that Sammamish at the time, the 2015 grant funding, this was before the addition of the Kahani money, was $176,000 for $3.57 per capita.
Councilmember Jaron.
Yeah, Joe, that's good. I appreciate that. And what we should keep in mind is that's nighttime population. And a lot of the social issues occur with the daytime population too, I would assume. So it does put us at the bottom of the per capita, and that's one of the things I was concerned about, but perhaps it's not as bad as could be perceived if you look at how many recipients of need are in our city, you know, how much we contribute to the budget of each of these social organizations. But I do feel that we ought to work towards increasing it.
I think so too.
Deputy Mayor Huckabee.
Is there a formula that cities use to determine how much they contribute toward human services, or is it decided individually by each city?
It's by each jurisdiction.
So we've made that decision to do the grant funding of that $176,000. So we could increase that if we chose to.
Correct.
Okay, Mr. City Manager, you wanted to?
Thank you. That is totally up to the council prerogative that if you wanted to increase it. It used to be $68,000 till about 4 or 5 years ago, and then it went to $176,000. What I would suggest the council consider doing it is that take a look at the criteria under which that you allocate these funds. Because based on the criteria that you had established, we're not getting that much more requests. I mean, when we look at it, I think every one of you serve on this Human Services Grant Committee one year or another. Literally, we're getting about 175, 176,000, or maybe 200 at the most one year, and actually a couple of years it was less than $176,000. So perhaps you can have some discussion on this next year, and then decide if you wanted to increase it in the 2017-2018 biennial budget.
Councilmember Whitten.
I want to comment, this is just the cash outflow. We also do a lot of other things. We do stuff in the housing area, which hasn't been recognized yet. We also have the properties that we lease at almost no cost to the social service organizations. And that is a giveaway of rent because it costs the city money to maintain and own those facilities. So I personally would like to see this figure probably significantly increased, but I do think when you're considering this topic, you need to take a comprehensive look at what we are in fact providing. These numbers, I'm sure, don't reflect free rent for a lot of service organizations and things, which, you know, on a long-term basis is pretty significant. So, again, I personally would prefer to see the number bumped up, and I've said that several times. But I think if you do that, you need to also take a holistic view and say, is it going to change your approach of capping it at a $10,000 or whatever it is?
Councilmember Valderrama.
And I was similar to the city manager, remembering where we began with this, and there were a couple of years ago where we were talking about how it was accelerating too quickly, the percentages. Additionally, as Councilmember Witten had just mentioned, we do have a lot of subsidies that the city is doing on facilities, including the $30 million for the Aquatic Community Center that's been put into for social and human services of the youth in our community as part of our contribution. I think the criteria is the most important thing to look at, as the city manager had mentioned, and to make sure that we're addressing it. I would rather see if there was a balance, that we start to look at how can we address the Arts Commission and being able to address that need, because I'm constantly hearing more about needs in the arts, and that might be something that we'd be looking at if we're not getting the requests in the health and human service, I mean the social and human services, to look at the Arts Commission, their needs, and that can be a discussion for a later date to look at.
Deputy Mayor Huckabee.
I would certainly agree that we shouldn't just bump it up willy-nilly, but I've been hearing some grumblings out there, some conversations about people potentially talking about safe sleeping.
About what?
Safe sleeping in the some of the church parking lots, which would allow particularly women with children who we know are sleeping in cars in our community so that they can, their children can go to school, that they can be supported. So that, you know, if we have programs like that coming along, and then there's been some conversation again about whether we can maybe adapt the backpack program that we see in the Bellevue area, which is providing food to children who get a free or reduced lunch, and then they have food on the weekend. So I'm not looking at, again, just bumping it up just because we're only spending the lowest amount. But if there are some really true programs that are serving some need in the community, I want to keep my mind open that we might want to support some of those and encourage some of that, especially as we grow to 62,000.
Just looking at these numbers, Bellevue and Redmond obviously are the ones that really increase their daytime population. I think Redmond nearly doubles their daytime population, and I know Bellevue is really significant. But I don't see these other cities. I know Issaquah, of course, has a retail, and a couple of other businesses there. They do go up in the daytime, but they're also more than twice what we're offering. So I would agree it's probably a good idea to look at bumping this up, particularly since some of these cities I don't think are, Kirkland doesn't have a huge, outside of retail, huge daytime population that's going to change their population all that much. It's really Redmond and Bellevue who are the ones who do that, and they're paying the money too. They've got the big money there for these things. Okay, anyone else? Mr. City Manager, you have a...
Just for clarification, if I could ask then, since we are making these comparisons, this is the direct cash from the other, this is apples to apples with what the other cities are doing compared to... So it was for the...
Yes, for 2015.
Right, it wasn't any of the other additional things that we're talking
no.
about?
And every city does some additional things also, as Council Member Witten suggested or stated that perhaps in our case that we have a place that we provide for youth counseling services. Because of all these good questions and good comments, that's why I suggest that you not make changes to mid-buy, but have a study session and then go through a thoughtful process and then make the suggestions for the 2017 and 2018 biennial budget process.
Okay, any other thoughts on that? Okay, let's go into the next one.
Moving along. Regarding the Community Development Department Planning Division, 2016 Professional Services, which is on page 21 of your budget.
We're eliminating the Community Development Department. That's why that's going on up there.
Is that why Jeff is here? We can fire in the public?
There is currently $0 budgeted for professional services within the planning division. And Councilmember Jaron's absolutely right. That's the perhaps urban forest discussion is one of many things that could come up in the work plan of 2016. Recall, we go over the work plans at the city council to retreat. And I can almost guarantee you there's going to be a need for professional services. However, when we do set our budget, we the consulting type of services, we don't just put a placeholder in there every year. We try to get it back to exactly what we're going to be contracting for, knowing that we have contingency funds if something does come up that we weren't certain about at the time the budget was established.
So you're saying you do have contingency funds for this possibility?
Right. Mm-hmm.
And we do, and we changed this practice to biennial budget process ago. Rather than making some predictions and tying the dollars in a certain particular pot, we basically said, let's just put in a contingency. If the council approves a certain programs or certain consultants, we can come back and ask for funds from the contingency funds to do so. And it's been working very well. So we haven't actually not honored any requests coming from council or direction any from council or internally that if we need to raise it, we came to the council, asked for that.
Okay. Let's go to the next one.
Next question. Oop, wrong button. In the non-departmental department, membership dues on page 28. There are several of the membership dues, especially the larger ones, National League of Cities and AWC, et cetera, where they should be adjusted for change in population, especially in 2016. It's been our practice. We update these every 2 years as part of the budget process. We did contemplate this way back when we were initially looking at the Klahani study and looked at it as it was going to be a change, but not significant enough to where we were going to put it into the fiscal analysis. So we will adjust this every 2 years. There will be an impact, and we typically absorb that through budgeting, and it hasn't been an issue.
So that same contingency fund, huh?
Yeah, but it's you're talking a couple thousand dollars on a $3 million of contingency, so that's why I say we monitor to it.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, no questions? Let's go on.
Okay, the last one, the real estate excise tax transfer to the street fund, which appears in pages 31, 39, 41, 42, and 44. And Councilmember Jaron is absolutely right. All the narrative that you see in the footnotes there speaks to our transferring of 35% of real estate excise tax revenue to the street fund. When in fact the budget reflects approximately 22 to 26% of the transfer. Recall back the first year we did this was 2013, where House Bill 1953 allows for the greater of $100,000 or 35% per year to be transferred use of REIT funds for maintaining assets already owned by the city. And so at that time, we transferred $385,000 from both the park CIP and the transportation CIP to the street fund to support the overlay program. At that time, beginning in 2013, that's when we saw the development really hit and our real estate excise tax was beating our projections. And we decided at that time to leave the numbers budgeted at $385,000 and not adjust it year to year, trying to catch up with our revenue projections. We do that and it's a hold harmless type of thing because when we did transfer the money from those funds to the street fund, we also backfilled that $385,000 each year from the general fund. So it was the intent of doing this was really to support House Bill 1953 because a lot of the other jurisdictions in our area really needed this to pay for maintaining their infrastructure. We weren't in such a spot at that time, but we wanted to show that we were supporting that. And so that's why it's budgetarily, we left it at $385,000, basically achieving the same goal.
This is a program we felt that our peer cities need it, and we lobbied hard. And one of our lobbyists out there is a former president of the AWC is sitting there. It was successfully passed legislation, but I think there were only two cities or three cities took advantage of this thing, and we were the only one, and I don't remember, Don, was there any other city besides us in the last time I looked at it?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
So we're the only city left using it, and we're using it to honor the spirit of the bill on this thing, not that we actually need the money on the operations and maintenance site.
I guess my suggestion is we take the 35% off the footnote, so because that's confusing.
Agreed. Right. Good catch.
Okay, we okay with that?
Good point.
Yes.
Okay, let's move.
Okay, absent any further questions, first
well, let's,
reading.
Let's just go ahead and ask for further questions. Are there any further questions? Push your button. Okay, Councilmember Valderrama.
Yes, as I was going through the presentation, Joe, I started to see quite a few numbers of staff appearing in different sections, and we've talked about them individually. So I'd like to know what is the total new additional headcount that's going to be happening. As I was going back through my notes, as I understand it, we currently have 80.5 as our headcount currently for 2015-2016. And while we had some earlier higher numbers, we had started in 2011 with 68.5, so we're back to that staffing level, and we have an infrastructure. So how many new headcounts do we have here? Because I was counting them up and they were getting double digits, it seemed to me. And although some of those are not full-time employees, some of them are partials that are coming on season.
Seasonals and maintenance workers always fluctuate. So
exactly.
We only focus on the full-time FTEs budgeted by the council.
So for the changes in positions, so we showed the two separate charts that track back to the personnel changes that were throughout the presentation. For Klahani, there were 5 FTE positions added. That included 3 maintenance worker, 2 positions, an associate planner, and the engineering technician. And there were also 6 seasonal positions, 3 of them 9-month seasonal, and 3 of them 4-month seasonal. Mm-hmm.
Population city, what they need, so in proportion basis,
significantly less than what it should have been.
So as it should, because we have an infrastructure here. Right. I don't want it to catch. Okay.
And then for the other positions added, the we're referring to as current Sammamish positions, there were 2.5 full-time equivalent FTE positions added, of which 2 of those were positions that were are currently in our budget. That were not full-time equivalent. They were the facilities position that we were performing the work with a 9-month seasonal for a year and a half, or roughly that there so, and also the management intern position that was converted to a management analyst. So 2.5 FTE addition and 2 part-time positions or temporary positions are eliminated due to that. And then there are also the 2 FTE positions that were added this year during 2015 off cycle, I believe April, May timeframe.
So we're going to be going to 90 approximately?
Correct.
Okay.
That still is the lowest per capita per thousand in the state of Washington.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. Any further questions?
I'll have another one. I'll hit the button again.
Okay.
On slide.
Only one question, Councilmember Valderrama.
All right. On page 31, and this now goes to the litigation services. So there's an additional 324, and that is for the balance of this year in 2016. Is that correct?
The addition of the $314,000 for additional litigation services in 16, no, that is money that we feel we're going to need in 2016.
Okay, so that's just for 2016.
Correct. Recall, we currently have a budget of $150,000. With the addition of the $314,000, it gives us a total of $464,000 for next year. Like I said, with budgeting there, but with the hopes that we do not need all that money.
80% of those is the land use litigations. It's the permits that we go through the hearing examiner process, and sometimes
the variances.
not necessarily so much the variances. I mean, the typical examples that I give you, like the Kinder Ace project that is still is being litigated after hearing examiner, after the court nights and the appeals court. So some of them just takes his own life, and obviously there's a cost associated with that. The part was insured, part was not insured. So the insurance, we talk about it another time in executive session. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's basically what it is.
Any further?
And then the council member Valderrama, so for your own benefit, that particular expense account fluctuates with the economy. As the economy picks up, as the development activity picks up, litigation picks up too. That's been the trend that I've been here for 16 years.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next steps.
So next steps, we'll be back tomorrow night for the first reading of the budget adjustment ordinance, the property tax ordinance, and the bank capacity ordinance we talked about because of the dynamic of the implicit price deflator. And then we'll also open public hearing, having the second reading of those on December 1st, as well as the three resolutions we typically bring forward, the salary resolution, the fee schedule resolution, and the medical premium contribution rate resolution.
Okay.
And again, all this information will be available tomorrow morning on our website. And as soon as the recording from this is available, the video from this session will be as well.
If there's anything that you wanted to be included in the ordinance, this is it. So if could you please?
I have a question. We had a proposal about the Klahani person that, or the assist on that, the storm project. We got a letter that all the council members received for, I think it was like $10,000.
Klahani?
I'm sorry, not Klahani, the Kokanee. Sorry, my bad.
Kokanee.
The Kokanee, it doesn't need to be budget line item. And wait a minute, now I think I did include that one in the budget for Count Draft. Refresh my memory. When I talked with you, what was your recommendation to me, that we would include that or we would not include that in the budget? This is the one that the Friends of Lake Sammamish, Kokanee, they're trying to hire a full-time FTE to help us to distribute those funds.
That wasn't Friends of Lake Sammamish.
Oh, no. That's the executive director.
It was the
position.
Storm
it's
organization.
The Kokanee work group. Yes.
Work group, not a Friends of Sammamish.
It is not unlimited. The Kokanee work group one. Yeah, no, we did receive the request. The request was done after we buttoned everything up, so it is not included right now in this.
Thank you for reminder. My strong recommendation for council that we honor that request. It's been a very helpful process for us, and we don't need to alter the budget. This is again another contingency expense for us. I would just do
we could have a motion this tomorrow night, or yeah, or even the first.
Yeah,
put it on my tab.
Making a budget.
Thank you. Thank you for the reminder.
But if it doesn't require a budget adjustment, then we don't need to do that.
Doesn't require a budget adjustment. It's
so we don't need a motion.
It's just basically, well, I was informing you that unless I hear an objection, we just
don't need a resolution.
No, we said it's within his authority.
But do you want a council resolution approving that?
I don't need the council resolution.
I
have
the. Sometimes you want.
Tomorrow.
We could have a motion, not including the budget, but a separate motion.
Okay.
If somebody wants to make that motion, think about what you want to say.
Thank you, Councilor
Valderrama. Councilmember Gerrand.
As follow-up of that, the Kokanee work group people have, with urban wildlife cooperation, have installed an underwater camera in Ebright Creek, and it's had some very interesting customers to the camera lens. They look like monsters from the deep, but they're really Kokanee on their way up the spawn. Maybe they're irritated or something, but the camera's been off and on. It's a little turbulent now, so they're showing footage from last Friday. So I encourage you to, it's on our website, isn't it?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody wants to watch it, it's there. It's a fascinating video. Mm-hmm. Not if you want to watch it 8 hours, but you just a little bit.
During the down times of Channel 21, you can watch the Kokanee.
They're cuter.
Okay.
That concludes the staff presentation. So again, this is not a new budget process. It's an adjustment. Actually, we did it more extensively this go around because of the Kohani involved on this thing. You have some good suggestions to have further discussion in the 2017-2018 biennial budget. I want to thank again Joe and Chris for doing an outstanding job, and we'll bring this first reading of the ordinances tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you.
That concludes the agenda. If the council has a patient, and this is a dangerous territory for city manager to go, item on not on the agenda, but it's a quick update. I just wanted to give you a 2 minutes update on the Snake Hill project, where we are on the progress. So John Cunningham, our public works director, we're trying to get this project ready for next summer construction when the school is not in session.
June through September.
Could he also give an update on that Thompson Hill issue? That
yes, please.
I told you this is a dangerous territory for.
And I want an update on the light synchronization because it's eliminating turning.
I don't know that John is prepared to do all of those tonight.
Councilmember Whitten, he is ready for the 212. Yeah. I'm not quite sure he's ready for this Thompson Hill yet, but. He's got, do you have pictures for the
we do have pictures
Lewis Thompson?
Lewis
I kind of told him that that might come up, so he might have it. Whatever the synchronization issue, you need to tell me, so we'll be prepared to do it at another council meeting. John, quickly.
Okay.
3 minutes. Yeah.
We'll quickly go through this. Everybody sort of recognizes Snake Hill there. You all know where it's at on the in the city. This is just a quick depiction of what the repair on Snake Hill is going to look like, and so we'll be using a reinforced earth retaining wall, and you can see there that we'll have what's called a chimney drain, which will catch the water that comes, the runoff that comes underground from the uphill side, will catch that and then release it down slope on the toe of the slope of the retaining wall. So that's just a quick picture of the repair. This one I think I can skip. These are kind of the major elements of what we're doing there. Total cost of the project, $9 million.
And we're doing also soldier piling some parts
of
the project too.
Yeah,
right?
Most of it is the earth wall, but there likely will be some soldier pile walls in some of the areas.
And what is soldier pile?
I can show a picture when we get to the Lewis Thompson Hill Road.
Okay.
Because that's the kind of wall we have there.
Okay.
Is that good. West Point Engineers? Is that what?
Yes, right. Yeah. Yeah. That's probably who it was named after. This is just a depiction shows the two parcels of property that we bought from the Brackmans. These are the parcels of property that will be used for the wetland mitigation that's required of the project because of the encroachment in the wetlands with our some of our slopes, and in the encroachment of the into the wetland buffers with some of the slopes.
And that's slight widening of the roadway.
Correct. Yeah.
What do you mean, John, by it's the wetland mitigation? Does that mean that those properties will stay as open space, or can we use that for tree replanting, or?
You can use a tree planting on the wetland.
On the wetland, yeah, on the wetland.
Well, you're mitigating the wider road, actually.
We're mitigating the damage that we're doing to the wetland and the wetland buffers by the widening that we have to do as part of the.
Because I'd heard some conversation that we might resell those parcels, so.
It looks like now that we will use virtually all of the Brackman properties for the wetland mitigation that's required on this particular project.
Good.
I thought we could, but staff told me that we need every piece of it for mitigation.
Because I was really hoping that we could put a lot of trees there because it's pretty straight bare.
Okay, so that's awesome.
This is just a quick breakdown of where the $9 million is being spent. The good news is the right-of-way is likely to be substantially less than $750,000. We paid around $150,000 for the Brackman properties. And we have just some slope easements that we still have to acquire in order to do the work. But so we should be substantially less than that on the right-of-way side of things. And then here's the where we are in the schedule. November of this year, we'll be applying for all the permitting, the environmental permitting that's required. right now toward the end of the first quarter of 2016 is when we'll advertise for bids for the project, beginning construction sometime in the spring and completing the construction in the fall of 2016. Right after school lets out, we'll be closing Snake Hill Road to through traffic so that we can get the project done and get all that work completed before school starts up again in the fall. So that's kind of the plan at this point in time. And that's the end of it.
Let's move to Thompson Hill, Lewis Thompson.
Oh, I had just one or two questions.
Sure.
What are the alternate routes going to be?
We haven't actually decided on that yet. We'll begin to talk about that and decide what we want to put in the specifications and how we're going to close Snake Hill. As we get a little bit further into the design, we'll be meeting with the emergency services folks. We'll be meeting with the school district and other folks just to kind of figure out what's the best alternative routes for them and how best to sign it. We'll try to get signing out early so people know that it's going to be closed early so they can begin to make plans for alternate routes around the 212. But
typically, if the road is closed for emergency vehicles, if in fact it's in a drivable condition, we always allow the fire and police to get through, right?
They have to get through, yeah, absolutely.
One of the concerns that, because I live there, one of the concerns we see, even though the road is supposedly unavailable to heavy vehicles, one of the problems is we don't let people know early enough. So for example, I hope you put in your notes that we should have detour signs someplace south of 43rd so people can go up 43rd.
Right.
Because what we see now is when people get to 212, they go up anyway because they don't know where else to go. And if we don't detour people early enough, they're going to end up on very strange roads like 24th and 196, which are much smaller, narrower, and much harder to get up and down. Sure. So I would hope that we would make sure that that signage is back in Issaquah. So
I think that's a great suggestion.
Thank you.
Any other questions, thoughts? Okay.
Okay, Lewis Thompson Hill Road. As you know, we did have a slide on Lewis Thompson Hill Road this weekend, sometime Saturday night, early Sunday morning. The good news is there was very little damage that was actually caused to the roadway itself. This is a picture of kind of looking down on the slide. You can see Zacoos Creek down in the down there in the sort of off to the left hand side of the photo. So this is a picture again showing Zacoos Creek and sort of the bigger area of the slide. What happened in this particular instance, this, you can see my pointer here, I hope you see the guardrail over here to the right-hand side, and then this right here is the top of the soldier pile wall. The soldier pile wall, for those of you who may have driven up the steep hill behind Fred Meyer, and you see the wall there that has steel I-beams standing on end, and then it has wooden, what's called lagging in between the steel I-beams, that's a soldier pile wall. It's tied back into the slope.
But the wood is always wet.
It's always wet and rotten.
Oh, yeah. It always. You have seepage out of that hill. Yeah.
Why would you put wood on a thing that's going to rot?
It's treated wood. Yeah. I mean, it's treated wood, and it'll last a long time. So
20 years if it's wet all the time.
Yeah. I can't answer that. In that particular case, every case is different. So.
I mean, I would just think you'd want a different material.
I was mad.
Yeah.
I don't know. Treated fur will last you 50 years.
Yeah.
I don't know what that is.
But it's not soaked all the time.
No. No, it can be soaked.
John, where did the actual water come from?
The water came from mostly on 210th Avenue. What we had is we had a culvert at the corner of 210th and Lewis Thompson Hill Road. They got plugged with debris and leaves, and so it overflowed, and then the water sheet flowed across Lewis Thompson Hill Road, and then came across the top of the soldier pile wall. We also had there's some plugged culverts up on 210th, which is a private road, so there's some plugged culverts up there, and the water, instead of going down the ditches that are along 210th flowed out onto 210th and then just flowed right down the right down 210th and across the intersection with Lewis Thompson Hill Road and then over the soldier pile wall. So basically the water came across the roadway and went over the top of the soldier pile wall here. It's basic, the soldier, top of the wall is pretty much even with the ground level there. So it just flowed right over the top. And then the earth that was filled in at the toe of the wall was washed away by the dirt or by the water coming over the top. That's what eventually caused the slide. And it actually, in a couple spots, washed enough earth away so that the bottom of the bottom board of the wall was exposed, and we had just a couple of places where the soil on the roadside of the wall actually gave way and went down underneath the bottom of the wall, and so that's what caused a couple of spots that we had to fix. So there you can see the guardrail's been taken out and to be repaired. That's an area where a tree from the slide area fell across the roadway and damaged the guardrail. There you can see the sort of the top of the soldier pile wall there. That's one of the boards right there that, that goes between the I-beams in the wall. There's another look at it. This is looking from the road side down at the wall. Here's the top board on the soldier pile wall, and then they've got a fabric, geotextile fabric that on the inside of the wall. And then these down below here is another four or five boards that run from I-beam to I-beam. You can see just off to the left-hand side, there's just a little bit of a showing of the I-beam, the steel I-beam. So these boards fit down into the webs of the I-beam. And under here, right down under here, is where this is one of those areas where the it, it when the soil on the outside of the wall was washed away, it went below down below the wall and brought some soil from the inside of the wall with it. This is the edge of the pavement. We actually didn't lose any pavement at all as a result of the slide. So there's a couple, 3 feet, two feet or so between of soil between the edge of the pavement and the wall, and that's what gave way. This is the second of the two spots. Looks really small on the top, but it was probably 5 or 6 feet wide by the time it got down to the bottom. Water kind of went down this post that holds the guardrail, and then off to the left as you're looking at it, and that's where underneath there was a pretty good sized void underneath this part of the soil here. And that's just kind of looking down down again on the slide area. That's the second, there were two points where that happened. The first one that you saw was the bigger one, and then this was the one where I just showed you by that guardrail post. This is a smaller slide, they're separated. They weren't all one big slide, they were actually two slides. And there's a big rock that they took that they took out when they were doing some cleanup. You can see the damaged guardrail there. Here's one of the areas, you can see the rock underneath the guardrail. This is one of the areas where we filled it in where it had slid out underneath the boards of the wall. So not a very large slide area, 2 feet wide maybe, or 2 feet towards the road and maybe 6 or 7 feet across, so relatively small. When we first got the call, I was very concerned that we'd lost half the roadway. So I was very relieved when I got up here and this is what we had.
Don called me, he was panicked.
Yeah, the email sounded like panic.
Were you adjusting the budget for 2016?
But we're doing the other end too.
And so here you can see one of the areas where we've basically repaired it. We will have to go back and do some more repair. Probably what we'll do is we'll do some armoring of the slope with some larger rock and soil, and then so we can fill it in so we don't lose more ground underneath the area where where the soil right now is lower than the boards are, so on the bottom of the wall.
John.
But this is basically finished here. We still got a little cleanup to do, but
just a quick question. Was this something that there was erosion prior to this, or
no.
Was it just totally a one-time event?
Totally, yeah, absolutely.
The
totally
water
a one-
was that? Yeah. Aggressive coming.
I guess it was really flowing down there from what
plus
I understand.
Plus a couple of plugged stormwater.
Who reported it?
Culverts.
We got the call from the police. I don't know who reported it to them, but we got the call from the police.
This is a very good reminder when I was out walking the dog today, because a lot of the rain is coming down, and I noticed that a lot of our culverts are starting to get plugged up because all the leaves are there, and there were some really wide streams coming down. But for people to maybe, because we are expecting that huge storm tomorrow night with a lot of rain and wind, and maybe to take a walk in the morning and see and maybe clean out some of those culverts so that the water can flow.
That would be extremely helpful. It's hard to keep up with as many culverts and as many storm catch basins as we have. And as anybody who has a big leaf maple around knows, it only takes three or four of those big leaves and you can plug off a whole catch basin almost instantaneously.
Yeah. And our culverts all flow to Snake Hill, so.
Exactly, yeah.
We didn't want to see this happening there.
Now, one of the things that we did do today is we did, as a precautionary measure, we had already cleaned some of the culverts along Lewis Thompson Hill Road further down towards East Lake Sammamish Parkway. But today we went through and cleaned them all out again so that hopefully we won't have this situation again. Here's
Councilor
probably
Jaron,
a better picture.
Do you have a question?
Yeah, John, on your first slide, you show Zacoose Creek, and it looks like there's erosion on the other side of the creek also.
Mm-hmm.
What's happening
over
there?
We actually think that the slide went down sort of through the creek and up, and then kind of came back down. And so we think what we see over there is deposit from the roadside of the creek that went down, you know, went up the other side.
Take a huge force.
That would have
been. So it was, I guess it was pretty noisy when it went from what we understand. So this is a picture here shows maybe a better shot, a little bit better shot of what the wall looks like.
Mm-hmm.
You can see here, this is one of those I-beams that stands on end. Over here is another I-beam that stands on end. And then they have, in this case, three, four, five boards. They're a foot tall, maybe, a foot tall, and they just stack right up on top of each other. So that's a little bit better picture, sort of what the wall looks like. And that's just looking a little bit at, we're kind of midway in the repair. And this might be, I don't think this is the first slide, but this is another look at the creek.
Especially the other side.
Looks like it did dam up the creek temporarily.
Yeah.
Councilmember Whitten, you have a question?
Yeah, some cities are doing a campaign to clean out the storm drains. I think that would be a good idea if our city could educate our residents on the importance of cleaning the drains through the city newsletter, maybe something on TV or even a mailer. Well, I guess that's the city newsletter. Because it makes quite a bit of difference, as we can see, especially when it's a private road that the city isn't responsible for maintaining.
And there you can see the crew. This picture actually was today. They were pulling a lot of the fallen trees down that had fallen down in the ravine and across the creek and things. They were pulling those out today and getting rid of those. So there's another, this picture is actually yesterday as they, so you can see a little bit of the debris there from yesterday when they were beginning to do their cleanup. And that, I think, might be the first one that I showed.
Well, the damage, we're done part of the repair, and I just talked with John today that looks like we will be able to complete rest with our own crew.
Correct.
There isn't going to be any budgetary adjustments or requests to do anything, so it's a small amount. John, you and I need to talk about what we put behind that retaining wall. It's the slippage plane that now moved. heavier material that we put there, it's going to increase the tension there. So we got to be careful what we put behind
Correct.
That. Mm-hmm. But we and I talk about that.
Councilmember Jaron, do you have another question?
Just one comment, John. Yesterday, I was coming home from Seattle, and I was driving by Thompson Hill Road, and I said, oh, it's open. Because there was no sign at the bottom, I drove the half a mile up, and then it said road closed. So you might, in those instances, think about putting a sign down at the bottom.
Absolutely, yeah. That's an oversight on our part. We definitely should have done that. Mm-hmm. And I have to admit, I did not go down to the bottom of the hill to see what the signing was down there. Mm-hmm. So thank you.
Councilmember Whitten, you have a question?
Yes, I have some questions about the light synchronization program on 228th. Mm-hmm. You know, when you wait three lapses, turns of the red light, and you still don't get a turn signal, you think the light's broken, and you're going to attempt to turn even though you don't have a green arrow, because that's what you're supposed to do, is stop, wait a reasonable amount of time, and then take a turn. Can you tell us what the parameters are I understand from what I've heard that left turners are going to be inconvenienced and have to wait longer sometimes, but I think there's a safety issue in terms of how long they have to wait. If the expectations are created to turn within one or two light signals, waiting beyond that creates a thought that the lights are broken and will cause people to do things that they're not supposed to. So my question to you is, what are the parameters for that? What are the criteria, the outer outliers, you could say, for inconveniencing left turners?
That's a question that I really can't answer in a short period, because the real answer is it depends, and I don't mean to be flippant when I say
that. I understand that.
Because it depends on the time of day. The new system actually looks at the whole corridor on 228th Avenue. The intent of the way it works is to move the traffic on 228th Avenue. And so it will look at all of the signals, and if you're sitting in the left turn lane, you probably don't think this, but it's smart enough to know whether or not, because of what's going on either downstream or upstream of the particular light that you might be sitting at with the traffic on 228th, it's smart enough to know whether or not it should interrupt that flow and give you, in this example, a left turn based on the flow that it's seeing that wants to go, you know, kind of against your movement that's coming up 228th. So it's not necessarily just the traffic that you see across the intersection that the system is seeing. It's seeing traffic two lights away, three lights away, and trying to get that platoon of traffic through 228th.
I understand, except it wasn't that crowded tonight, but what I'm suggesting to you is people are not expecting, this is America. We wait our turn, and then when it's our turn, we expect to go. And waiting three lights is more than an inconvenience. People at that point, based on the history, think that the light is broken. So I think what the city needs to do is have a very strong education campaign telling people this will be common. I think really if you don't know it, you think the light's broken when you don't have an opportunity to turn. So I think you need to create that expectation or change the light systems.
Yeah, I would agree with you 100% that this system operates differently than people are used to having a traffic signal operate. People are used to being able to count on it basically doing the same thing every time you're there. Every cycle, it looks the same basically no matter what. This system is not designed to do that.
It's a
now,
dynamic system.
Having said that, we do want to hear about these kinds of things because
a 5-minute wait is too long.
I would concur. A 5-minute wait is outside the parameters that the system is designed to work in. So we do need to see those things because if it isn't operating the way it's supposed to, we need to know that so that we can go in and do some reprogramming and make sure that it's that, you know, it's not missing something for some reason.
But I think that's good, so we can keep, and I think that should be, I really think you need to educate people because there's going to be an accident. That people will go either out of frustration or because they think the light is broken. Mm-hmm.
Good comments. We know.
Yeah, those are great comments. Absolutely.
I mean, I think you need to get the press involved and describe the system
and for those for those people who do have those kinds of things that they want to let us know, it's really important that as best they can, they tell us at what time it happened. Because otherwise, we can't go back in and look at the system and find out, you know, without looking again and again, and for looking at a lot of data, we can't find out exactly
tonight.
What was going on. Yeah. So we got to know where and about what time, you know, and what happened so that we can really make the system operate effectively. So, yeah.
Deputy Mayor Huckabee, you have a question?
That's extremely helpful. Because it's driving me nuts. Because I come out on Issaquah Pine Lake Road, and it's unpredictable. Sometimes I get a left right away, sometimes I'm not. But at that particular intersection, and I'll try to remind my neighbors, too, to communicate with you on the timing issue. Because the problem there is that when you're trying to make a left turn, and the left turn signal's not coming up, people jump into the through lane, go across, and where it goes down to the two lanes, go into the parking lot, and then come out on 228 through the parking lot. And so that is probably not something that we want to encourage. It's a
probably
habit
not.
People have, but we might want to correct that at some point.
Yeah, I mean, it,
Councilmember Gerrand.
Thank you. John, I didn't realize it goes through several cycles and not let you turn, because I just came out on Southeast 24th. That's, I believe it was 601. and I waited a long time for the main traffic going through, but it didn't go through two cycles. It let me turn left before it went through another cycle. So
it will, the way the system operates, the way it used to operate, if you were making a left turn, you got what was either called a leading left turn, which came on, you know, sort of at the beginning of the cycle, or a lagging left turn, which came on at the end of the cycle. Mm-hmm. The way the system is designed to work now is you could get either a leading left turn or a lagging left turn, or you could get a left turn indication in the middle of the cycle, depending on what's going on in the system.
But it doesn't really skip you and go through a couple of cycles, does it?
It shouldn't skip you and go through a couple cycles.
Right.
If that's what's happening, then there's something wrong that we need to figure out, and we need to figure that out.
I reported that was doing that, and you took that information. I haven't had it happen to me again.
It shouldn't skip you, but it could be.
Member Valderrama?
I was curious and reminded that in Issaquah and Bellevue, they have the flashing yellows and during it. Would that be a consideration to have here?
Yeah, actually.
Well, at that particular left turn, it's a sight distance issue.
Yeah, Mike.
At that particular intersection that the council member Whitten is talking about, left turn into the commons, we have a sight distance issue, that the vertical sight distance, that you don't see far enough the vehicles coming from the northbound. Yeah, okay. We can't do the flashing on that one because of that reason.
Unless you gun it.
But what are you going to do when they back up into the travel lane?
Well, I think that what Public Works Director said, he heard something new. He's going to talk with his IT engineers, the traffic engineer. We're going to take a look at it. He shouldn't be doing it what you're describing to us that it did. That's not what it should be doing.
But my question is, when...
You won't, because there's a loop detection system there. It recognizes it. It's smart enough to recognize that the static vehicles are storage in that particular...
In the travel lane?
On that left-turn pocket.
No, what I'm saying is, right in front of my house, you know, which is the busiest block in the city, cars often stack up from the left-turn lane, which you just extended into the left travel lane. Mm-hmm.
You know, actually, it helped that intersection because I use that left turn every day and multiple times.
It does, but it also stacks up. Is your system designed to permit left turns when it stacks up and blocks a travel lane?
It does. It's because what I'm telling you, that intersection particularly is working better on the left turn moments.
I found just my own experience coming south on 228 that the left turn lanes during rush hour, evening rush hour, much better. More people are getting the left turns because it recognizes that there's more traffic going south from 8th Street. And
that particular left turn used to block one of the true lanes on 228.
Yes,
that's why the system recognized that, particularly because, again, what John said is the importance of the moving the 228. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And what was happening at that intersection, the queue was spilling over to the true lane, and then effectively 228 was down to one single lane.
Exactly what I was saying, yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Anything else?
I think
no, that was
we're done.
Wow. Okay.